God, because he loves us so much. John 3:16 says, and hello online City Church, welcome. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, he loves us, that he gave his only son, that whoever is with him, he will give eternal life. How good is that?
Amen.
Amen. Are you so happy that God loves you so much? Come on, let's worship him.
You were away.
chosen.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me.
Thank you.
got a good response. Isn't God good?
Yes!
You scared me for a minute. I thought maybe you had second thoughts, but all right. You can be seated. And we're excited this morning to have another graduation. And this morning we're graduating Chop. Come on up, Chop. All right.
I just want to say thank you to Pastor Scott and Pastor Deborah and to all the staff and the facilitators and all the residents. And I love you guys all.
Proud of you. Come a long way. Ladies and gentlemen, 1 year!
All right. Pastor Bill, will you pray? We're going to pray for Chaw. He's graduating, going to stay for a while. But let's stretch out our hands and we're going to pray that God blesses him immensely, that God opens the right doors and he closes the wrong doors. And the Bible says that the steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. And Cha has been a righteous man, and God is going to start ordering his steps down the right road. Amen? Amen. Pastor Bill.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for the miracle that stands before us here at City Church. Yeah. Heavenly Father, you say you honor our heart as long as we give our heart to you. Cha came here a year ago, Heavenly Father, and he gave his heart to you, his emotions to you. We ask, Lord God, that you guard his heart and his emotions, Heavenly Father, because we know this world and Satan has a way of touching and using the emotions to pull a man or a woman or child astray. Heavenly Father, continue, Lord God, to order his steps, Lord God, and remove any deceiving spirits out there in this world, Lord God, that will try to have him go back to his old ways like a dog returning to his vomit. Heavenly Father, put your holy protection, Lord God, and your holy angelic host, Lord God, let them continue, Lord God, to protect and guide him, Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for the many opportunities and doors that you've opened, Lord God, for Chow here at City Church. We thank you, Lord God, for sending him back to his community, Lord God, that he will be an example unto you, not in perfection, Lord God, but honoring you through the love that you showed him and through the love he's going to show others, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for, again, removing all the things of doubts and fears that Chow may have come here with, Lord God, that you, Lord God, will give him a new way of thinking and a new way of seeing this world, Lord God. We just want to say thank you and amen.
Amen. All right. Amen. Chaw, by the way, Chaw is one of our main cooks, and you all experience his cooking on Sunday, so let's give him a thank you. All right. I've asked Pastor LT, I would like to, on Sundays, I would like to start praying for our nation. Stuff is happening. It just keeps happening. And I think we as City Church, I think we can raise up a standard against the evil that is happening. And it starts with us praying collectively that God will touch this nation. So I've asked Pastor LT to lead us in prayer. And would you do me the favor of just standing while he prays and agreeing with him? Amen.
Amen. When I got the text this morning, and Pastor Scott was asking me if I would pray, and not limiting City Church, but just, he said, pray for the nation. I'm talking about the nation, and I didn't take it lightly. I immediately asked God to just humble me and just ask that his Holy Spirit just fill me and just speak through me. So this is some serious business. There's a lot going on in the world today, and especially in the United States of America. And the Bible says that our struggle is not against flesh and blood. So we have to understand what that really means. Our struggle against principalities and things and high places. So we have to know that our weapons are not carnal in nature. Our weapon is that we God has equipped us with is spiritual. He has given us the sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit is His Word. His Word. And God says that when He speaks His Word will not come back void. It will not come back void. And I'm telling you guys that the Bible says that in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. So whenever we speak the Word, we're actually speaking God into the situation. If you can understand what I'm saying. Because God is His Word. He is His Word. So when he said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Anything that was not made except by the Word. So we have to understand that in whatever situation we find ourselves in, when we speak the Word, we're actually speaking God into the situation.
Yes.
Amen? So now we see what's going on. The devil is loud, and he's getting louder and louder and louder. And I'm going to tell you, the church is sitting by watching it. It ain't saying nothing about it. And I'm telling you right now, Pastor Scott said, we city church is going to raise a standard up. He's going to raise a standard. Last Sunday, he talked about people be running around talking about, I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. But ain't nobody's on the battlefield. Ain't nobody's on the battlefield. So right now, we're going to start putting some bodies on the battlefield. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We're going to start calling it out just like it is. We're going to start calling it out just like it is. Amen. We're going to stop walking on eggshells in the church. We're just going to stop it. We the real deal. God has not given us a spirit of fear. He has given us power, love, and a sound mind. Amen. So with that being said, and we all on one accord in this place right now, in this time and in this moment, we say, Heavenly Father, thank you. Father, we thank you for your grace, and we thank you for your mercy. Father, we thank you for loving us, Father, and keeping us, Father. And Father, right now we're asking for your Holy Spirit, Father. Father, in your word you said that the whole world is waiting for the sons of God to be real, to be revealed. And I'm telling you, Father, we know that you are up to something. We know that you're up to something, and it's good, Father. It is good. What the devil meant for evil, you mean for good all the time, Father. And Father, right now, we're not going to focus on the problem. We're going to focus on what you said, Father. We focus on you, Father, and you alone. We're going to glorify you, Father, wherever we go. We're going to magnify you, Father, and we're going to exalt you, Father, from now on, Father. It's not about us. It's all about you, Father. Father, we're walking in your grace and your mercy, Father, and your passion, your power, and in your authority, Father. And so, Father, right now, these words, Father, that I'm speaking out of my mouth, Father, let them be as powerful as they could ever be. And let them touch everybody's heart in here, Father. And touch the households of every, the men, Father. The men. The men. The Bible says we're living in God's permissive will. So He's allowing things to happen. I don't want to go there, but Father, thank you. Yes. Let your Holy Spirit have His way, Father, in us and through us, Father. Let us not be ashamed of the gospel, Father. Wherever we go, Father, we abort that enemy's mission, Father, right now in the name of Jesus, Father. I don't know what to pray for, Father. You know what I'm trying to say, Father. You know what I'm trying to say, Father. And Jesus Christ, I'm asking you to do what you said. Intervene for me right now, Father, on our behalf. We give you praise and we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes. Children are dismissed. You know, as we prepare for our deposits, you know, it's time that you and I get our hearts and minds ready. And that unity that Pastor LT was talking about for our nation starts simply with something that touched me a couple days ago. And I got up and something like this. This came just to me, and maybe it'll touch your heart just as well, but for the nation and for our community. I just simply said to myself, I remind myself that every day that I'm blessed to be alive, that love is an action, and it produces feelings. Love is not just words that I say to someone, and my giving of love is not predicated by what I think I deserve to get in return. You see, the world has a way of telling you and I not to love each other. See color, see creed, see religion. But God is based on love. So love, once again, is an action. And as you and I sit here, our action, like the Word of God tells us, is going to tell me where my heart at. So as I get prepared to put my deposit into our containers, that's going to show you my actions of where my heart and my love is. See, if I have a love for God, my little one penny, I understand it ain't about the penny I put in. It's about collectively the pennies that we put together, the pennies and nickels that we put together through love that will continue to bless this community and the world. You see, that's what love is. It's an action that brings upon a feeling. So when I do this, I feel good that I know lives are changing here, not just here at City Church, but throughout this community. To our Facebook givers and people who are watching on Facebook, we thank you for joining us in unity through love of giving and depositing right here at City Church. No, you may not be here physically with us at this church, but understand it's through the love of your action that you are depositing into good ground here. Because we here at City Church are able to see the people coming, being fed day and night here at City Church. Lives like Child's being changed here, mind, body, and soul. That's love. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for giving each and every man and woman an opportunity to give from their heart. And it doesn't matter how much. It's just my willingness to give. And through my action, I'm feeling real good right now because I know that it's touching lives. So we thank you, Jesus, that you've given us that opportunity to show love through obedience and sacrifice that will change not just Fairfield, but again, change this community because people are watching you and I. Oh, we claim that we love, but all of a sudden, I don't want to talk to you. I can't talk to you. But that's the lie of the enemy. So again, Lord, thank you for what you're doing here at City Church through our loving, kind spirit. Protect and guide and put your hedge of protection over this church that no harm or danger come against anything that's being done here. The weapon may form, but it won't prosper. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So March the 26th is a parent conference. That's a Sunday, and that will happen right after church that Sunday. We'll have lunch for you. If you have children in the kids zone, I would encourage you to sign up for that. The sign-up sheet is in the lobby. And the reason for that is the teachers in our kids zone would like to discuss with the parents what they're seeing in the children as they interact in the kids zone, and to hear from you parents your concerns and your desires regarding your children. So a great opportunity to connect, and I would encourage you to do that. So we're going to jump right in this morning, and I wasn't sure that it was a smart thing to take another run at a part two of last week, but I decided, I just felt God say, yeah, go at it again. So we're going to go part two of where we were at last week, and this should wrap it up, but I'm really concerned. The more I am become familiar with what's happening in our country and in our state, and right here in Solano County, I become really, really concerned, because a lot of it, most of it, is not good, let me just say. I have a pastor friend in the East Bay right now. Well, he was, this goes back about a year. He runs a preschool, and they came in during the pandemic, and they said that all of your preschool have to wear masks all day long. Well, I'm an adult, and you can't get me to put a mask on for a whole day, much less take a two-year-old and expect them to wear a mask all day long. Those of you that have two-year-olds, those of you that have worked with children, you know what I'm talking about. That is an impossibility. But they said, if you don't do that, we're going to close you down, and we're going to fine you X amount of dollars per day. And he said, well, I can't do that, so we're going to close the preschool. It's no longer a licensed preschool, and we're just going to have day camp for all the kids in the church. So because it's day camp, we don't fall under any licensing, so you can't tell us what to do. Well, he did that, and they filed lawsuit, they filed charges, they filed criminal charges, and his attorney told him that you are getting ready to go to jail. They'll probably pick you up within a couple of days. They're going to bring you to jail. They're going to fine the church thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars, probably foreclose on the property to pay the debt that you now owe the state. And good luck. Well, they haven't put him in jail yet because they're afraid of public opinion, because the church holds about 300 people. And there are enough people that go to the church and enough people that work at Livermore Laboratory, so they pulled back a little bit, but they keep threatening that this could happen. There's a pastor down in Southern California that pastors a Calvary Chapel who has been in court this week and has thousands and thousands of dollars levied against him and the building, and they filed charges, I believe, against him personally. Now, I don't know the latest, whether he's looking at jail time or not, but I think that's a strong possibility. Why do I tell you this? Because it hasn't come this close to us. I've not been told I'm going to jail. I came close to it a few months ago. I told him, you're going to have to lock me up before I do what you're asking me to do. So you just go ahead and put me in jail. I have enough people in the church that'll come put money on my books so I can... I'll buy toothpaste and cup of noodles, and I'll give them all out to all my friends in jail now. So you do go ahead and do that. But things like this concern me, because never in my lifetime have I seen stuff like this happen. And it's escalating. It's escalating quickly. So let me do this. So the question comes, and it, for those of you that don't follow churches and church policy and politics, let me tell you, there is a great divide right now in the church. And there is a segment of churches, of believers, that believe that the church should not speak politically, that the church should not have a political view. Now I can say historically, we do not tell people who to vote for. In fact, we only suggest, not by way of name, we only suggest by know the platform, know what that person stands for, and vote intelligibly and vote responsibly, because your voice has a say. Now, we've stayed away from political issues, we've stayed away from a lot of that, and we talk about the issues within society, not the political issues. Now, what I'm saying is most churches won't even do that because they're afraid of the repercussion. They're afraid that people will leave the church. Now, years ago when we had an election, I read the platform of what each candidate stood for, and I had a whole section of people get mad at me and walk out and never come back. Because I dared read, I didn't make it up, I was reading what each candidate stood for. You draw your own conclusion. I'm not telling you I'm not even telling you who I'm voting for. I'm just telling you, know what they stand for. Be intelligent when you vote. And I had a group of people leave. So I know that I run the risk right now of upsetting some folks, and I'm willing to take that risk. If you get upset, well, you'll have to take that up with God. But I want to talk about our position as a church. I don't know that we need to be leading marches and stuff like that. That's not what I'm saying. But I am saying that there are a lot of churches today that will not take a stand on anything. They won't take a stand on anything. They could have sheriff's department locking the front doors and they would just go, it must be God's will. We'll just go home and pray about it. They will not take a stand on anything. I believe that God is calling us to take a stand. Now, I don't have all that. I can't tell you what that all involves. I don't know, but I think it starts with our praying every Sunday and taking a stand against evil. And God may open some other doors where it will involve taking steps of faith and doing some things. I'm not sure, but I believe that we have an open heart and we're saying to the Lord, Lord, send us, and God will begin to open the right doors for us to do that. And as I thought about it, and I thought about the mentality today, it is because of that mentality among churches that in part that is why we're where we're at today. Because there isn't a voice of righteousness. There isn't a voice saying that God is the answer, Jesus is the answer. There isn't a voice for morality. There isn't a voice to stand against the evils that the enemy, that Satan would throw at us. There isn't a voice. That voice is silent today. And those that speak out get criticized, get ridiculed, get threatened, have legal action brought against them, have local authorities come up with all kinds of ways and codes and everything to come against them to make life horrible. And that's what we've recently experienced. But what it does to me is it makes me want to get more vocal and fight harder, because I don't believe that we should be intimidated by what Satan throws at us. We have the ability, we have a big God, and we have the power to throw it right back at him. So, where are we at today? China sent over some balloons, scared the EBGBs out of half the public. The news is lit up with there's a global power that's going to take over the world and take over the United States. And all you've got to do is flip channels and you'll see that being talked about. What does that do? That puts fear in people because they're afraid of that. They're talking about food shortages right now. And I don't know. I haven't seen any real shortage. I mean, I've gone to the store and looked for those little Chinese noodle things that Deborah likes to put in the salad. They haven't had that for about 3 weeks. So I went to go look for the little soup crackers to put in the salad. They haven't had that either. Does that mean it's a food shortage? I don't know. But I know that there are some things that are coming up short, and there are shelves that are a little bit bare. So what does that mean? Does that mean that they're going to tell us that they're going to run out of toilet paper like the beginning of the pandemic in 2020 and everybody runs to Walmart and buys every pack of toilet paper they can? People are scared, and people will do crazy things when they feel they're in threat. They're talking about another pandemic. Another pandemic. My Lord, haven't we had enough? But they're forecasting another pandemic. We argue whether to take the shot or not take the shot. Man, you could go crazy. They're telling us the banks are going to freeze the accounts, and there's already a couple of banks that have done it. An extreme situation, but they're saying that that is, our president has said that he will freeze accounts. I'm not making this stuff up. The president himself said that he will freeze accounts. They're talking about Social Security being gone by the time some of you reach the age that you can collect. Last week, we talked about the loss of parental authority in the schools. That is gone. It's not happening. It is already gone. So it's a little bit too late to catch that train. It's gone. Parents don't have authority in the school. They've taken it from you. People are afraid of the unknown. What's coming next? What's going to happen next? What's this world coming to? Global warming. They're still talking about global warming, and California's flooding, and half the United States is covered in snow. Go figure. I've seen articles on social media where people grabbing snowballs and putting a match to it, and the snow won't melt. They're calling that the seed particles when they seed the sky. Some of you believe that, some of you don't, and I'm not here to argue it. All I'm saying is people are afraid because there's so much unknown. Is the snow real? Isn't it real? I don't know. Did it come from particles in the sky? I don't know. Some of it's real, some of it's not real. Why are we getting so much rain? I don't know. But it is abnormal, if you ask me. I watched something yesterday or the day before where the lady was displaying a new tattoo that they have that actually, the permanent tattoo they put in you that tracks you. It tracks where you go. It tracks who you talk to. It tracks all your social media, that tattoo. They also now have it in a pill form that you swallow the pill, and it's got a micro nano nanny chip in there or something. And when it hits the fluids in your stomach, it comes alive, and it too tracks you. Now, I'm not making this. I saw the pill, and I've seen the tattoo. I know that that is real. Now, are they going to roll that out to society? God knows. But I know that they have already created it. So where it goes, I think, in part will depend on you and I. So when we look at what's happening in the United States, when we look at what's happening close to home in our state, California, and in our county, Solano County, when we look at all that is happening, it reminds me of a time in Israel's history. And it reminds me of a time of Elijah and Ahab and Jezebel. Now, some of you don't recall the encounter there. I talked about it a few weeks ago where Elijah went up against the prophets of Baal, and he said to the nation, "Why do you halt between two opinions? If God be God, worship him. If Baal be Baal, you worship him. And let's just call it, let's have a showdown right now. The God that answers by fire is the true God." And God performed a mighty miracle. He sent fire. He licked up the water. He disintegrated the stones. He licked up the sacrifice on the altar. It consumed everything. It was a fire like nobody has ever seen. And then Elijah takes a stand and says, "Kill the 350 prophets of Baal because they're false prophets with a false God." And they did, as a nation, they did that. But what preceded that was God had spoken something to Elijah. And Elijah met the king of Israel, Ahab. He went and met him, and he found him on the road. And he said to Ahab, he says, "I'm going to tell you something. I am going to stop the rain from coming, and it will not rain in this entire nation until I say for it to rain." Why did God do that? Why did God instruct Elijah to do that? Because as a nation, they were being run by tyrants. Both Ahab and Jezebel were absolute tyrants. In fact, there's an indication in Scripture. The Bible does say Ahab was more evil than his predecessors, and Jezebel was about as wicked as they come. A nation is being ruled by people like that. We have corruption all over our political, all over our elected people. There's corruption everywhere. And it rises almost to Ahab and Jezebel. What am I saying? I'm saying, as it is today, so it was then. An entire nation didn't know who to worship. Do we worship Baal or do we worship God? Well, the tyrants were requiring them to worship Baal. But in Baal worship, part of Baal worship was you sacrificed your firstborn male child. How would you like it if that was law today? In fact, how many here are a firstborn male? Raise your hand. You wouldn't be here today. You wouldn't exist if people obeyed that law and it was law. Well, that's what this nation is under. A God, supposed to be God-fearing nation, supposed to be God-following nation, but they're not following God, they're following Baal, and they're listening to these tyrants dictate how they're to worship. So Elijah says, it's not going to rain. Why did God pick rain? Because Baal, whom they worshiped, was the god of rain. In fact, it was said that when Baal creates rain, it is like the oil that flows. So God said, if you're going to worship Baal, a false god, and he's the god of rain, watch this. I will stop the rain over the entire nation, and it won't rain until I say it will rain. And that's exactly what Elijah did. He went and told Ahab that. Well, Elijah goes into hiding for 3 years because Ahab is seeking his life, thinking this crazy guy stopped the rain. We got to kill him. And there's famine all over the land. People have no food. There's no rain. Nothing will grow. And they're starving to death. I mean, and there are stories embedded about, well, it's bad. It's really bad. They're desperate. And then one day, God says to Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 18 and verse 1, says, and it came to pass after many days that the word of the Lord came to Elijah, and in the third year, saying, go present yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain on the earth. Go present yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain on the earth. And he does that. They have the showdown, him and the prophets of Baal, and when they're done and he kills the 350, he said, get ready now, because, and the people say, we will serve God, we will serve God, God is God. When they begin to do that, God now sends rain. God sends rain. And Elijah says, I see a small cloud. There's a cloud coming. His servant says, I see the cloud. And Elijah goes and tells Ahab, you better run for the city, because when God says rain, it's going to be like a torrential downpour you've never seen before. And rain comes. In many ways, when people start serving God, when they stop serving God, God turns them over to the evil that they're following. Let me say it this way. When a nation stops serving God, God will often let them have what they dream up, because there is no voice of righteousness. If you want to serve Baal, serve Baal. But guess what? Baal ain't going to make it rain, because Baal ain't a god. Rain comes from the Lord, Jehovah Almighty. That's where rain comes from. So if you want to serve Baal, then you serve Baal without rain. Our society right now is serving a Baal. Our society is following false gods. Our society is not following Jesus, is not following Jehovah. Our God, our society today has turned away from God, and God is giving them what they want. You want deception? Go ahead and have it. You want famine? Go ahead, it's coming. You want evil to rule you? Go ahead, you got Gavin Newsom. Yeah, I said that. And he's got Biden. Go ahead. If that's what you want, go ahead. I'll give you what you want, but you will not have my blessing as a nation. We are operating right now under God's grace, but we are not operating under God's blessing. And I've lived long enough to know the difference. We're existing under God's grace because of the church, because of you and I. God is having grace on a nation, but God is not blessing the nation. And when we stop doing, and we stop being the church, we won't even be operating under God's grace anymore. And what you think you have now will be gone. So God had a specific time and moment for Elijah to be a voice. You know, one day when I go to heaven, I want to meet Elijah. I do. I sometimes I sit and I just fantasize of what kind of a guy is this? What kind of a guy walks up to a king as evil as Ahab was and his wife Jezebel, walks up to this king and said, "Buddy, I've got news for you. It ain't gonna rain until I say it's gonna rain." How do you like that? That takes something. That takes some courage. I mean, that takes some chutzpah. That takes something that most people don't have. One man all by himself. He didn't go with a crowd. He didn't go with voters. He didn't go with a team of people. He walked up to him by himself and said, "Dude, let me tell you what's going to happen. Because of your evilness and the evilness of this nation who follows you, there's going to be no rain." Let me back up. Because of your evilness and the evilness of a nation who follows you, what happens when a nation doesn't follow an evil leader? What happens? God will take the leader out. But when a nation agreeably follows an evil leader, the evil leader stays. Because God, there's nobody standing in the gap to say, "God, we want righteousness. We want righteousness. You got to take the unrighteous politicians out." So God gives the nation the unrighteous politicians because they're not going to be in Elijah. The absence of a voice speaking out equals a voice that condones. If you don't say something about it or against it, it means that you condone it and accept it. And that's where the church is today. So, how do you know when it's time? How do you know when it's time? The best example to me is David and Goliath. In 1 Samuel chapter 17 and verse 26, "Then David spoke to the men who stood by him, saying, 'What shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?'" Now, without reading the whole story, they're in battle. Israel is on one mountain range. The Philistines are on the other mountain range, and there's a valley between them. Goliath, the Philistine giant, who is the head of all fighting men, he's their go-to guy in battle. He marches down into the middle of the valley and he says, "Somebody come and fight with me. And if they win, we will be your servants. But if I win, you be our servants. Why waste all this human life by going at it, all of us? Just send one guy down." Nobody will go. They all see Goliath, and when he threatens and shouts, they all, the Bible says, they take a step back. They're so scared. Nobody will go. David comes, who's a shepherd boy at this time, and he's actually coming to bring his brothers food. His dad said, leave the sheep that you shepherd, take these breads and cheese and stuff, and go visit your brother on the front line and make sure they have ample food to eat and give some to the commander. So David is on a mission. He's not there to fight. But while he's there giving his brothers food, this giant comes out and threatens the armies of Israel. He defies the armies of Israel. So David asks the men, what happens to the guy that goes down and kills him? Because I'm sure he gets a reward from King Saul. What happened? And they tell him what the reward will be, but nobody will go down and kill this giant. So David says, he stands up. Saul hears about it. You got a young guy there that's questioning why nobody will go down and kill Goliath, but he's acting like he wants to go do it because nobody else will. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 45 and verse 47 says, David, as you know the story, he gets a sling and he gets five rocks. He's determined, I'm going to go down and I'm going to kill Goliath. But here's the thing. God never told him to do it. He never waited for God to tell him to go. In 1 Samuel 17, he says, you come to me with a sword and a spear and with a javelin. He's telling Goliath this. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you, and I'll take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the beasts of the earth, that all earth may know that the Lord does not save by sword or spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. How do you know when it's time? Sometimes God will tell you the time is now. Sometimes God expects you and I to know. We don't need to ask. David, when he's talking to Saul, David said, listen, I may not be a great warrior. I'm not a fighting man. I've never been in battle ever. I'm not even in your army. But when I was tending the sheep, a bear came out and stole a sheep. And I went and I wrestled the bear and I killed the bear to save the sheep. And a lion came out on another occasion and took the sheep. And I immediately jumped into action and I ran out and I ripped the sheep out of the lion's mouth and I killed the lion. David didn't have to pray about that either. Because while he was praying, if he were to pray, the sheep would have been eaten. There would have been nothing to save. The same with the bear. Well, God, should I be a bear hunter? Should I be a bear killer? I don't know if I should do that. While he's praying, the bear would have ate the sheep. What David did was he jumped into action in order to save the sheep. Without thought, without contemplating, without a voice from God, he just jumped into action. He does the same thing in the presence of Goliath. None of you guys want to go kill him? He's defying Israel. He's defying the armies of God Almighty. None of you want to go shut him up? None of you want to do that? Okay, get out of my way. I'm going. I'll be the guy that goes. You know, God would have used any one of those guys on the front line. Any one of them that would have ran down on that battlefield, God would have anointed them, empowered them. He wasn't dependent on David. It just so happens David was the only guy to say, send me. I'll go. I'll do it. Nobody else will. I'll do it. That's what I'm saying about City Church. Maybe nobody else will go. And that's between them and God. But I don't know about you. We see a level of evil that most churches don't. We see a level of evil that most churches don't. Most churches aren't involved with the jail system. Most churches aren't involved with the unhoused. Most churches aren't involved with addiction. Most churches don't have a clue as to the evil and the destruction that Satan does to lives. But we do. We know. We know firsthand. We see Goliath where most people don't. Other churches don't know Goliath on the battlefield. We see him. So if other people say, I'm not going, I think City Church should raise their hand and be the first to say, God, let me at him because I'm going to take that guy out. I'm not standing for this. I'm not sitting back and watching this play out. I'm going to go make a difference. I'm going to do something. I may not have all the weaponry. I may not have all the money. I may have a sling and five stones. But we just read the battle is not to the one with the sword and the javelin and the armor. The battle is the Lord God Almighty's battle. And he'll take a sling and a stone and he'll destroy enemy with it. You use what you got. Psalms chapter 119 and verse 126 says this. It is time for you to act, O Lord, for they have regarded your law as void. When people regard God's law as void, it is time. It is time to react. It is time to react. You don't have to ask God if it's time to react. I think he just said it. It is time to react. David had told Saul, he said, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be one of them, after he told him about the bear and the sheep. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God. That's all David needed. You defied the armies of the living God, I got to kill you. Esther, let's look at Esther. Esther chapter 3. If you've never read the book of Esther, I would encourage you to read this book. There is no other example as strong as this example of somebody who came to take the Jews' lives. And Esther did what she was supposed to do and how it turned absolutely everything he meant for Mordecai and the Jews turned around and fell on him personally. Amazing. It's almost comical to read. They ought to make a movie out of it. So we're looking at verse chapter 3, and I'll kind of paraphrase for the sake of time. But in chapter 3 and verse 8, and Haman said to King Xerxes, there is a certain people dispersed and scattered among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom whose customs are different from those of all other people who do not obey the king's laws. Now what happened was is this king had made Haman one of his chief nobles. And Haman was a man of power under the king. And as such, other nobles would bow to him and bend a knee. Mordecai never bowed to Haman Because Mordecai believed that you only bow to the Lord God. You don't bow to a man. And Haman hated Mordecai because Mordecai would not bow to him. Haman found out that Mordecai was a Jew. They had conquered Jews. Jews were a part of their nation. And they didn't hold to the customs here of Xerxes and his nation. So Haman decided that the way to kill Mordecai would be to go to the king and complain about their customs not being in line with our nation, and we ought to annihilate all the Jews in our captivity, which would include Mordecai. So he does that. He goes to the king and he says they don't obey the king's laws and it is not in the king's best interest to tolerate them. You shouldn't tolerate. And if it pleases the king, let a decree be issued to destroy them. And I will put 10,000 talents of silver into the royal treasury for the men who carry out this business. So the king took his signet ring from his finger and he gave it to Haman, son of Hammedatha and Agagite, the enemy of the Jews. Keep the money, the king said to Haman, and do with these people as you please. So the story goes on that he sends word to all the provinces, and he said, on this day, you all come out and kill all the Jews that live in your province. Kill them all. And you can take all of their belongings as plunder. Now, what Haman doesn't realize is that King Xerxes has taken a new bride, a queen, the queen. He got rid of the old queen. Now he needs a new one. He's got the new one. And she happens to be Esther. And Mordecai is her guardian. And she is brought into the king's palace and prepped for a year with oils and smelly salt and all of that. Prep for a year. And she goes before the king to spend the night with him. He's so pleased with her, he makes her the number one, and she becomes queen. He doesn't know she's Jewish. You with me? Because Mordecai said, don't ever tell anybody you're Jewish, because we're the second-class citizens in this nation. Don't ever tell them that. And she doesn't. Now we come to chapter 4. When Mordecai learned that what had been done, he tore his clothes and put sackcloth and ashes and went out into the city, wailing loudly and bitterly. That was a sign of their sadness. They put on sackcloth, which is like a potato sack, and throw ashes on themselves. Glad we don't do that today. But he only went as far as the king's gate because no one clothed in sackcloth was allowed to enter it. What? The king did not allow sad people in his court. If you came in and you looked sad, it just meant that he would kill you. In every province to which the edict and order of the king came, there was great mourning among the Jews, and fasting, and weeping, and wailing. Many lay in sackcloth and ashes. Of course, they're going to die in a few weeks, and they know it. And when Esther's maids and eunuchs came and told her about Mordecai, she was in great distress, and she sent clothes for him to put on instead of his sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther summoned Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs assigned to attend to her, and ordered him to find out what was troubling Mordecai and why. See, she hadn't heard the news that all the Jews were going to be killed. She's in a protective environment. She doesn't hear the news that everybody else hears. So Hathach went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city, front of the king's gate, and Mordecai told him everything that had happened to him, including the exact amount of money Haman had promised to pay into the royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. And he gave him a copy of the text of the edict of their annihilation, which had been published in Susa, to show to Esther and explain to her, and he told him to urge her to go into the king's presence to beg for mercy and plead with him for her people. Hetesh went back and reported to Esther what Mordecai had said. And then she instructed him to say to Mordecai, all the king's officials and the people of the royal province know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the matter of the court without being summoned, the king has put one law that he be put to death. The only exception to this is for the king to extend the gold scepter to him and spare his life. But 30 days have been since I was called to go to the king. Now, she's saying that he hasn't called me in 30 days to make love with me because he's got a harem of women and he picks who he's going to sleep with nightly or sometimes with nobody. And she says, I thought I was his favorite because he elevated me to be the queen. But he hasn't called for me in 30 days. I don't know if he's found somebody else that's prettier than me or has better sex than me. But he hasn't called me in 30 days. And nobody goes before him. You don't walk into his presence unless he asks for you. And if you dare to walk into his presence, it meant death. You die. Unless he extends to you the golden scepter. When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer. Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. Don't think that just because you're the queen that you will escape, because the law is signed by the king that all Jews get killed. That includes you. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows, but you have come to the royal position for such a time as this. Who knows? Do you get what he's saying? If you don't go before the king, don't think you're being protected because you're his wife. If you don't go before the king, you will die with the Jews. God will raise somebody else to deliver the Jews at a later time, but at this time, they will be annihilated and you will die with them. Who knows if God hasn't put you in this position for such a time as this? I've often asked God, why me? Why me? Why did I have to be born at this time? Why did I have to be born in this era? Why did I have to be born at this time of political unrest? Why me? I could have been born a generation before. Why me? Who knows if you and I have not been born for a time such as this? Who knows if you're here by design, by heavenly purpose, for such a time as this? To be an Esther, pleading for her people. Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat and drink for 3 days, night or day. And I and my maids will fast as you do. And when this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. So Mordecai went away and carried out all of Esther's instructions. Well, the story goes on that the king gives her favor. And he promises her up to half of his kingdom. And then the story takes a dramatic twist And she lets the king know how Haman had sought their destruction, and the king turns then on Haman and has him hung on the gallows that he created for Mordecai. Who knows if City Church isn't here for such a time as this? Who knows? Who knows if God didn't bring you to City Church for such a time as this? Who knows? But I do know this. I do know this. That if we do not speak out, and if we remain silent, you and I will be annihilated. Now, it may not mean that all of this is going to happen in my lifetime, but I guarantee you that if we're silent, it will happen in your children's time and in your grandchildren's time. Because you think it's bad now, you think it's evil now. Let evil prevail, and you haven't seen anything yet. Somebody's got to be the Esther. Somebody's got to be the Elijah. Somebody's got to be the voice that challenges a nation and a people to say, we stand for righteousness. We stand for God. This is one nation under God, and you're not going to change it. We still want God on our money. You see, the church has stood by silently. In June of 25, 1962, school prayer was banned. We stood by and prayed about it and lost. Why didn't people flood the schools? Why didn't people flood school meetings? Why didn't people raise a voice and say, we want prayer in our school? Why didn't people stand and do that? Why didn't churches arise and go to the school board and say, what are you doing? We want prayer to remain in school. We want God's word in school. Why didn't we do that? Because we didn't want to get political. So while we didn't want to get political, they kicked God out of school. And we wonder why the schools are so messed up today. Teaching things that if you knew as a parent what they were presenting, things that you would never let in your home, but they're teaching it. Abortion was legalized January 22, 1973. Again, the churches did nothing and we lost. We lost. I wonder if the millions and millions of babies that have been killed, if God in some way, shape, or form doesn't hold the church responsible. Why weren't Christians marching on Washington, marching on abortion clinics, raising a voice against it? We have an abortion clinic here in Fairfield, and there's a small number of people that stand with signs off of Texas. It's funny, Travis, I'm sorry. It's funny that most of them come from the Catholic Church, because the Catholics believe in life. But what if every church in Solano County went down there and occupied that lawn in front of that abortion clinic? I wonder how many abortions they would do in a week. What if instead of telling women you shouldn't have an abortion because it's not right in God's eyes, why not take that scared female who maybe didn't ask to be pregnant? Why not tell her, carry the baby full term, and when you deliver, I'll adopt your child. I'll provide a home for your child. I'll give you an answer to your dilemma. You give birth, and I will adopt your child. Why don't churches have adoption agencies within the church? A group of people, married couples, that say, you know what, we're planning to have two children, but we may have one, but we're going to adopt the other. Or we'll adopt both. You see, instead of calling it sin, we should call it sin, but we should also give a solution. But I don't know of one church that has an adoption agency within the church. I don't know, I'm just asking. But could it be that had we done something, there wouldn't be the amount of abortions we see today? And I wonder if God holds us responsible. Why weren't you the voice? Why didn't you say something? That little child in the womb was counting on you. Why didn't you say something? There is two words for time. I'm going to leave you with this in one verse. One word for time is the word chronos. It's where we get our word chronogram. Chronos means it's a season. That's chronos. Sometimes God will lead us as a people into a season. The other word is kairos. And that word is, for time, it is a moment. God will lead us in seasons, but then God also leads us in moments. A moment is when you do something now. That's a moment. Now, at exactly this time, right now, you do it. That's a moment. We tend to want to exist in seasons, never considering that some of those seasons have ended, and it's kairos time. It's moment time right now. It's not a season anymore. It's a moment time. Leave you with this, and our worship team is coming. Ezekiel chapter 22 and 30 says this, "So I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land." Did you catch that? This is God speaking. God said, "I sought for a man among them who would make a wall, a barrier, who would make a wall and stand in the gap between me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it." One more time. I sought a man. One man. I sought a man among them who would make a wall, create a barrier of defense, make a wall, and stand in the gap between me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it. You and I right now, we are standing in that gap that God would not destroy America. We're standing in the gap. But then God says, "But I found no one." That's probably one of the saddest verses in the entire Bible. I sought for a man that would stand in the gap, that I would not destroy the land, but I found nobody. Nobody would stand in the gap. I don't know about you, but I want to be the guy in the gap. I want God to say, "I sought for a man that would build a wall and stand in the gap, and I found Scott." I want God to say, "I sought for a church that would stand in the gap and be the barrier so that I would not destroy the land, and I found City Church." I want to be that person. I want City Church. I want us to be that person. And here's what I believe. I believe that God will begin to speak to you and tell you what that wall looks like. I believe God will say to you what that wall looks like. It might be going to the abortion clinic. It might be that. Maybe that's the wall God's going to speak to you. It might be an adoption process. It might be something that God's going to speak to you to tell us as a church that we need to do it as a church. It might be writing some letters to some very high officials over some issues and let your voice be heard. See, God will speak that to you. And then we need to act. We need to act. Strike force. We're going to close it today because of the rain. And I was told that James said, raining is going to close anything. Rain or shine, we're still going to minister to people, even if we get wet doing it. Well, you know what? I admire that. That's another wall. That's another wall. That's a barrier we're putting up. And God bless James and Mindy for taking a stand like that. Not too many people want to go out there while it's raining and get wet, but they will. And you're welcome to join them. That's at 3 o'clock today. You're welcome to join them. Raise your hand. This is James and Mindy right there. Amen. Let's all stand together. And I'm going to ask you, while the worship team closes us out, just look deep within your heart. And maybe you need to say, God, I'm willing to be a wall builder. I'm willing to stand in the gap. Call me. Tell me what I can do, and I'm willing to start doing it. Amen? Together, we're a mighty army. Did you know that? Together, we're a mighty army. Not to be fooled and messed with. We are a mighty army. We're the army of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you. The truth, Lord God. It is our weapon, Lord God, against the evil, Father God. We thank you, God. And as we go, as you raise us, Lord God, as we go forth, Lord God, we believe that you will equip us, Father God. You will equip us as we go about and stand against the evil, Lord God, in this life, in our community, in our family, Lord God, in this city, in this nation, in our state, God. We thank you, God, that your word is our weapon, Lord God. You, Father God, is a victory in our life. Father God, we just thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Sometimes you gotta pay reduce. So don't worry, just push on through.